every large-scale internet service that I'm aware of, they're all incredibly bound by the cost of the data center. And within the data center, they're from an architecture standpoint, they're I/O bound. So we deal with very few internet applications at scale that are CPU bound, as contrasted to I/O bound. And then, of course, the way the economics work are, it's all about power and cooling and efficiency and space in the data center. And so the opportunity with ARM servers, or alternately with much more power efficient servers, server chips coming from other vendors, including Intel, the opportunity exists for like another 5x reduction in data center cost by packing a lot more server chips into the same data center. And I think especially for these I/O bound applications, I think the transition will be more seamless than people think. In the long run, it's the grand unification of the smartphone supply chain and the data center supply chain. And I'm a radical on this. I think that data centers in 10, 15, 20 years are going to be running many of the same components as run in smartphones. And I think the ARM-based processor is, you know, sort of case study number one, and flash storage is case study number two. And I think those are coming very quickly, and then those will come sweep back through servers, and then ultimately networking and storage.
It's interesting, you know, even here at a conference dedicated to change, you talk to a lot of people who will say the opposite, that ARM is not going to happen. Yeah. You can talk to 50 people who say one thing, 50 people who say another. Where do you come down? Is this going to happen?
ARM 32-bit was kind of limited in terms of memory addressing, let's be honest. Now, ARM 64-bit solves that problem. The other thing is, the world needs higher clock rates. So a cell phone is like at a gigahertz or 1.2. One really needs, 2, 2.5, 3. That makes it a lot more interesting. And, these things are sort of in flight or in flux. And I don't know exactly when they're coming out, because there were some announcements here earlier today. But there is definitely a race towards, the lowest power, highest performance, highest cost performance kind of metrics. And the big advantage in the cloud is that many people own their own software stack. They're not limited to what's
discussed here and around this project was made possible by software. And so in particular, innovation around open source, in particular, kind of the sledgehammer effect that Linux has had on the market makes possible a lot of what we're all talking about with what's happening with hardware now. The other thing that I just think is so incredibly important is the implications of open source plus open hardware for radical reductions, as I know Mark Zuckerberg talked about yesterday, radical reductions in price and cost for building systems, which then makes it possible for software to do many more things than it was able to do before. And so when I think about Software Eats the World, I think about software becoming much more important in fundamental industries, education, healthcare, financial services, media, many, many other areas of business, and being able to have very inexpensive hardware at high volume makes it possible to build a lot more software and have software become much more important in the world.
So to take that cycle even further, what that does, even driving down the cost of hardware, that feeds this new breed of cloud services,
right,
which allows me, if I'm a startup, to get off the ground so much easier,
yeah,
right? I don't have to buy hardware. I don't have to buy servers and storage gear and networking gear. So you think that the future is, are these cloud services, and that the data center, so to speak, is dead, at least for the smaller players?
Well, so we see it every day. So we see two things every day. So one is we see, it's become a cliche, but it's absolutely true, is we see startups come in doing some sort of fundamental new software innovation, again, and often in very important areas like education or healthcare. And it's, two or three or four kids with their laptops, and their laptops are their entire CapEx budget for the company for the first 2 years. Like, that's it. And they're deploying entirely onto cloud services. They are, by the way, their business also is running entirely on cloud. That's the other thing is, all the new companies are running entirely on systems, Salesforce.com, Box.net, Google Apps. We just backed a new company, Zenefits, which is a cloud-based service comprehensive for HR and benefits. And so these new companies can basically all run entirely on the cloud, both for their own purposes and for all the business apps that they need. So as a consequence, the amount of money required to start a new software business, is tiny in comparison to any historical precedent. $500,000 gets these companies 2 years of runway to be able to develop their product. We see it on the other side, though, with the companies that are scaling. And so I see this, Mark talked about this yesterday, I see this every time I go to a Facebook board meeting, it's like an out-of-body experience for me. Because I look at the CapEx budget at Facebook, and in one sense, it's a lot of money because Facebook's buying a lot of hardware. On the other hand, had Facebook existed, in 1999, the CapEx budget would be somewhere 50 or 100 times bigger than it is. Facebook would be spending like $100 billion a year on capital equipment, which, of course, is impossible, which means, of course, Facebook could not have existed in 1999. So then I think when you project forward and you look out 10 years, you basically start to ask this sort of really interesting question, which is, if services like Facebook and Google are made possible today because of much lower cost, higher volume hardware, and then you project the curves for hardware out over the next 10 years, the services that are going to be made possible 10 years from now are going to be mind-blowing in their sophistication and in their power. And they're going to make things that we, you know, think today are very powerful and compelling look completely trivial in comparison. So we're entering, I think, an entirely new era for what software is going to be able to do as a direct result of what's happening in hardware.
So how about you, Andy? You sell hardware into the data center. Are you of the opinion that the data center is dead?
Well, even Sun used to sell hardware into the data center. Now, historically, most computers were bought by businesses, you know, one at a time. And there was a great business for computer companies until about, I don't know, 5-10 years ago, let's just say. Yeah. These days, the computer is the data center, right? It's no longer an individual computer, it's the whole thing. And what the traditional IT industry kind of missed here is that there's a completely different optimization required to build things cost effectively for the very large scale data centers than if you sell one at a time. You know, it doesn't matter whether it's Dell or HP or IBM. I guess IBM sold their hardware business. And at scale, you know, you can optimize for power, efficiency, connectivity, fabrics in a very different way. At the same time, you know, the spending has actually shifted. So if you look at where the growth in the market is for hardware vendors, the traditional IT business is actually either not growing at all or declining, or it's basically flat to declining. All the growth is in the cloud. So the cloud CapEx budgets for Facebook, Google, and sort of if you take the largest six US public cloud companies, it has been growing 35% year over year over year. And if one extrapolates this a couple of years in the future, somebody actually predicted that the cloud CapEx spending in by 2020, I believe, will exceed all the North American carriers combined. So all the stuff that, you know, Verizon and AT&T is putting into the ground or into the wireless station is actually smaller than what these six cloud companies are going to spend just on enabling software. So all the action these days is basically in the cloud. And what my most recent company is doing is focusing on network switching for that segment of the market, which is what we call cloud networking. But again, even there, we have to optimize equipment to have the capacity and the power efficiency and the cost performance to make sense, whereas the more traditional kind of networking equipment was actually off by at least an order of magnitude.